Hello and welcome to the Maths 2 component of the online BSc program on data science and programming. In this video, we are going to continue from the previous video where we discussed the theory about the relationship between images and kernels for a linear transformation with the column space and null space of the matrix that we obtain after we fix ordered basis for the domain and the codomain. So, we are going to do a bunch of examples where we implement what we have seen earlier, and we will find basis for the kernel and the image using the fact that we can find basis for the column space and the null space using row reduction. Let us just recall first what I just said. So, we have defined in the previous video what is the kernel of a linear transformation. For a linear transformation F V to W, let A be the matrix corresponding to F after choosing ordered basis beta, which is V1, V2, Vn, and gamma, which is W1, W2, Wm for V and W respectively. How do I get this matrix? Well, you apply F on Vi and express that in terms of the W1, W2, Wm, and then the coefficients that you get, you put all of them together and you get your M by N matrix. Once we choose the basis V1, V2, Vn, we have this isomorphism Rn to V. And what is the isomorphism? If you have a column vector in Rn, C1, C2, Cn, then that corresponds to the vector summation Cj, Vj, right? You take the corresponding linear combination. That is the isomorphism from Rn to V. And in the previous video, what we have discussed is that if you consider the null space of the matrix A, which is a subspace of Rn, then under this above isomorphism, that gives you an isomorphism with the kernel of F. This was the import of the first part of the previous video. So, in particular, if we can get a basis of the null space of A, then using this isomorphism, we can translate it to a basis of the kernel of F. Okay, that is one of the things we will do in this video for concrete examples. Okay, similarly, we define the image of a linear transformation, and once again we can choose ordered basis, and then we get the matrix A. And now we have an isomorphism from Rm to W. This is because of the choice of ordered basis W1 through Wm. So, if you have a vector D1, D2, Dm, corresponding to that vector, you have the linear combination summation dj, wj. The main point here is that if you look at the column space of A, which notice is a subspace of Rm, then under this isomorphism, its image will be exactly the image of F. Okay? So, that is what we discussed in the previous video when we talked about the relation between image and column space. And in particular, what this will do is it will tell you that if you can get a basis of the column space, then by using this isomorphism, you can also get a basis for the image of F. Okay, and we will implement this in some examples now. Okay, so let us do this example. Consider the linear transformation from R4 to R3 defined by T of x1, x2, x3, x4. Which is 2 times x1 plus 4 times x2 plus 6 times x3 plus 8 x4, x1 plus 3 x2 plus 5 x4, and x1 plus x2 plus 6 x3 plus 3 x4. Okay, so the first thing we have to do is choose ordered basis. So, let us choose the ordered basis to be the standard basis for R4 and R3. So, once we do that, what is the corresponding matrix? Where it is exactly the coefficients of that are appearing in this linear transformation. The first row is the coefficients appearing in the first equation. So, those are 2, 4, 6, 8, and then 1, 3, 0, 5, and then 1, 1, 6, 3. Okay, so, let us row reduce. So, if you row reduce, well, what do I want to do? Maybe before I reduce, let us ask. We want to get the basis for the image and the kernel of F of T, and to do that we have to get basis for the null space and the column space, and we know how to do that by row reduction. So, that is why we are row reducing. Okay, so if you row reduce, well, we have a 2 in the 1 1th place, so we divide by 2. So we get this matrix 1 2 3 4 1 3 0 5 1 1 6 3. Sweep out the first column below the 1. So that's R2 minus R1 and R3 minus R1. So if we do that, we get the first row is unchanged 1 2 3 4, and in the second row we will get 0 1 minus 3 1, and in the third row we will get 0 minus 1 3 and minus 1. Okay. So already you can see that the third row is a multiple of the second row, so it's going to get knocked out in one more step. Well, in the one, so we are done with the first column. So now we look at the 2-2th entry, it's conveniently 1, and so we can knock out the entry below that. So that in fact knocks out the entire third row by doing R3 plus R2. Fine. So now this is already in pretty good shape, but let's do one more step and convert it into reduced to echelon form. So to do that, we do R1 minus 2 R2, and then that gives us 1 0 9 and 2 in the first row, and then 0 1 minus 3 1 0 0 0 0. So that is the reduced to echelon form. So 1 0 9 2 0 1 minus 3 1 0 0 0 0. And from here we can read off the basis for the null space and the column space. Okay, so let's look at first what are the non-pivot and the pivot elements. So the pivot elements are in the 1-1 and 2-2 place. So the non-pivot columns, which will correspond to independent variables, are in the third and fourth columns, and that tells us that x3 and x4 are the independent variables. X1 and x2 are dependent variables, and if we put x3 is s and x4 is t, then we can use the first row and the second row to get the corresponding equations, and from there we will get that x1 is minus 9s minus 2t and x2 is 3s minus t. So just to be clear, this is in order to get the basis for the null space. So for that we have to look at the homogeneous equation. So that's what, that's how we are getting these equations for x1 and x2. Okay, and what that means is if you substitute s is 1 and t is 0, or s is 0 and t is 1, this give you two basis vectors, and that will constitute the basis for the null space. So if you do that, what do we get? So if s is 1 and t is 0, we get -9, 3, 1, 0, and if s is 0 and t is 1, we get -2, -1, 0, 1. So that is a basis for the null space, and since we have chosen beta to be the standard ordered basis, the basis for the kernel of t is exactly the same. So it is -9, 3, 1, 0. How do I get that? That is because we take the linear combination of the corresponding ordered basis, and in this case that is -9 × E1 + 3 × E2 + 1 × E3 + 0 × E4, which is the same as the vector you started with, and similarly for the second one. So we have got a basis for the kernel of T. To get a basis for the column space, note that the pivot columns are the first and second columns. So that means from the original matrix, if we look at the first two columns, those will be a basis for the column space. So that is the vectors 2 1 1 and 4 3 1. So just to remind you, here's the matrix. So the first two columns are, in the first column you had 2 1 1, in the second column you had 4 3 1. Fine, that's a basis for the column space. So that tells us that again, that since we chose the standard basis, the standard ordered basis, the image of T also has the same basis. So 2 × E1 + 1 × E2 + 1 × E3, which is 2 1 1, and 4 × E1 + 3 × E2 + 1 × E3, which is 4 3 1. Okay, so I hope this example demonstrated how to implement what we studied in the previous video. Let's do one more example where we'll use bases which are not the standard bases, and so we'll have to actually compute what the what those linear combinations are. Fine. So let's look at V is R2 and W is this subspace of R3, x, y, z, such that x plus y plus z is 0. So let's look at respective ordered bases. So beta is 1, 1 and 1 minus 1 for R2. So notice I am not choosing the standard ordered bases here, but the ordered bases 1, 1, 1 minus 1. So for gamma, let's choose the ordered bases minus 1, 1, 0 and minus 1, 0, 1. Let's look at the linear transformation. T of xy is 0 comma x plus 2y comma minus x minus 2y. Fine. So of course we know this is a linear transformation from R2 to R3. How do I know it's a linear transformation to W? Well, if you look at the image, that is inside W, because the vector 0 comma x plus 2y comma minus x minus 2y satisfies that the sum of these three is 0. So 0 plus x plus 2y plus minus x minus 2y is indeed 0. Okay. So this is a linear transformation from V to W. Fine. So now let's write down the corresponding matrix. So here we will have to do some work, right? So here we have to take the first vector in the basis, which is 1 comma 1, and then apply t to that. If you apply t to that, you get so t of 1 1 is 0 comma 3 comma minus 3, and then we have to express express that in terms of the basis gamma. So 0 comma 3 comma minus 3 is 3 times minus 1 comma 1 comma 0 plus minus 3 times minus 1 comma 0 comma 1. This is something you can check, and that gives us our first column, which is 3 minus 3. Similarly, for the second basis vector, we have t of 1 comma minus 1. So that will give us 1 minus 2, which is minus 1, and then minus 1 plus 2, which is 1. So we get 0 comma minus 1 comma 1, and again it's a check that this leads to the column minus 1 1 in the second column. So this is our corresponding matrix. Okay, this is something if we have done this in the previous videos, so I will encourage you to check this. So now we want to get the basis for the column space and the null space of this matrix. So to do that, we will put it into reduced row echelon form. This is a particularly easy matrix. So you divide the first row by 3. So you get 1 minus 1 third minus 3 1, and then sweep out. This is actually clearly the second row is a multiple of the first. So you will get 1 minus 1 by 3 0 0. Okay. So this is in reduced row echelon form already. So now let's check out what are the pivot and non-pivot columns. So the pivot column is the first column, the non-pivot column is the second column. So x1 is the corresponding variables, x1 is the dependent variable, x2 is the independent variable. And for the homogeneous equation, x1 satisfies, so x1 minus 1 third x2 is 0, so x1 is equal to 1 third times x2. So if you put x2 is t, then x1 is going to be given by t by 3. So a basis for the null space is we can obtain that by putting t is 1. So if you do that, we get the singleton set which is the basis, namely 1 1 third comma 1. So this is a basis for the null space of A. Now from here I want to get the basis for the kernel of T. So remember, we have chosen the basis 1 comma 1 and minus 1 comma 1. I'll just sorry, 1 comma minus 1. So right, beta is 1 comma 1, 1 comma minus 1. So now we have to take that linear combination, 1 third times 1 comma 1 plus 1 times 1 comma minus 1. So if you evaluate that, that gives us 4 by 3 comma minus 2 by 3. So that is a basis for kernel of T. Now, of course, you can simplify this basis. So you can pull out the 1 third, or you can pull out the 2 third if you want, and instead of this basis, you can write the basis as 2 comma minus 1. So that's another basis for kernel of T. Okay. Okay, so similarly, let's go about what happens to the column space. Let's see what happens to the column space of A. So that's so to do that, we have to see what is the pivot column. So the pivot column was the first column. So that means the first column of the original matrix, which was 3 minus 3, is a basis for the column space. So now we have 3 comma minus 3, and so what we should do is take the linear combination 3 times the first basis vector in gamma plus minus 3 times the second basis vector in gamma. So if you do that, we get 3 times minus 1 1 0 plus minus 3 times minus 1 comma 0 comma 1, and that gives us 0 comma 3 comma minus 3. So this is the basis for the image of the linear transformation T. So I hope this example has again shed more light on the calculations that we, or the theory that we saw in the previous video. So let's end this video with the rank nullity theorem for linear transformations. We have actually studied this theorem for matrices. So now, because we have this very nice connection between the null spaces and the kernel and image and the column space, we can convert the rank nullity theorem for matrices into a theorem for linear transformations. So suppose T V to W is a linear transformation, then the rank of T is the dimension of the image of T. This is the definition, and the nullity of T is the dimension of kernel of T. So based on what we have studied earlier, notice that in order to compute the rank, we can choose ordered basis for the domain and codomain, and using that we can get a matrix, and the rank of T will be exactly the rank of that matrix. And similarly, the nullity of T will be exactly the nullity of that matrix. So if we reinterpret the rank nullity theorem for matrices, we will thus obtain rank of T plus nullity of T is dimension of V. Why dimension of V? Because remember that what we will get is rank of the matrix plus nullity of the matrix is equal to n. What was n? N was the number of columns in that matrix. But what is that number of columns? That number of columns is corresponding to the dimension of V, right? So hence we get dimension of V here. Okay, so I guess that ends this video. Thank you.